Ghostbusters is one of those movies that basically everyone agrees is good, even people who haven't actually seen it. Its presence in the popular culture is such that its goodness is generally taken to be as much of a given as that it features both ghosts and the busting thereof. If you've seen it, chances are pretty good you love it. Even if you don't love it, chances are you like it. Even if you don't like it, you probably don't hate it. And even if you hate it, you probably long ago resigned yourself to the idea that it's simply not the film for you, that its charms are effectively lost on you and that you, not Ghostbusters, is the problem. It's a film that has permeated our popular culture. Other films use it as a reference point. Its catchphrases and zingers are part of the cultural lexicon. It's impossible to describe characters like Peter Venkman or Egon Spengler without defaulting to those very men, who by now have eclipsed whatever archetype from whence they may have been drawn. Ghostbusters has been sequelized, merchandised, video-gamed, ecto-coolered, animated, reanimated, and it's on its way to being gender-flipped and rebooted. It's not simply enduringly popular, it's a film that has become one with our shared cultural essence. But does it deserve to? Popular cinema, particularly the popular cinema of the 1980s, is littered with films whose stature is at odds with even the most generous appraisal of their objective quality. This is particularly true of films that spawned ancillary empires aimed primarily at children, which Ghostbusters most certainly did. It's entirely possible that for many audiences who came to the property from the sides, the original film is afforded an undue boost in affection, owed more to lingering nostalgia for toys and cartoons than its own merits. Is that what happened? Is this film a genuine comedy classic, or just another over-merchandised 80s genre flick permanently cast in rose-colored hues by nostalgic Generation Xers? Is Ghostbusters really that good? Let's get the basics out of the way first. The main reason we're still talking about Ghostbusters is that it's an astonishingly well-made film that manages to feel effortless in its undertaking. It presents a high-concept premise with a surprisingly coherent mythology in strokes exactly broad enough to not be at odds with a breezy comic tone, but strong enough to have real weight and matter as a story. If you don't understand a single joke, the overarching narrative of an upstart team of paranormal investigators coming up against an ancient malevolent deity is entirely compelling. But if you don't really care about the occult machinations drawing Gozer the Gozarian back to the 20th century Manhattan, the central comic observation conflating the roles of exorcist and exterminator is just really, really funny.
Somebody saw a cockroach up on 12.
That's gotta be some cockroach.
Bite your head off, man. Going up.
I'll take the next one.
When you couple that with a group of comic legends who also happen to be gifted character actors, and also Ernie Hudson, but you know what, we're going to talk about Winston in depth a little later, playing at the absolute top of their game in an ingeniously well-balanced screenplay that gives each Buster a coherent character, but doesn't let any one character overwhelm the piece, not even Venkman, whose entire personality is about overwhelming and filling up space, that's pretty goddamn impressive. In fact, let's start out by talking about those characters. The first thing that everyone thinks they know about good storytelling is that characters are supposed to have arcs, i.e. they're supposed to start the film with an incomplete goal or an incorrect outlook or a personal flaw, and over the course of three acts, they're supposed to achieve, learn a lesson, or otherwise improve themselves, thus providing a framework for the rest of the story. But Ghostbusters doesn't really do that. One of the most interesting and unremarked upon things about Ghostbusters is that it effectively opens in media res. The four heroes arrive in the story already fully formed by events we're never fully privy to. That's because it's unnecessary for the record, but we'll come back to that too. It's an easy mistake to call this an origin story, because the first act is about going into business, but in terms of the film proper and the story it's telling, that's not really the case. Think about how much important story and what modern-day franchise blockbusters would call world-building has already been handled before the film has even unfurled.
My parents left me that house. I was born there.
When we meet the three founding Ghostbusters, Egon Spengler, Ray Stans, and Peter Venkman, they've already met and become friends, already agree that ghosts are real, already have a theory about exercising them through science, and already have the basic Ghostbusters business plan cooking behind the scenes of their research. Granted, none of them appear to have actually encountered a ghost until they find the one in the library, but once they have, they already know what it is and what they're planning to do next. On one level, this is just efficient storytelling, but on another level, it's establishing a setup whereby the film gets to be itself. The whole comedic hook of the film is watching this grand invasion by dark forces occult adventure story play out in mostly serious terms, while four snarky heroes react to it in funny ways, and since there'd be less room to be funny if they also had to stop and explain the plot and their motivations within it constantly, the film relegates all that business to passing references to pre-film events, trusting that the screenplay is sharp enough and the actors good enough to get all the necessary data across in passing. And it turns out, they are. As a result, the Ghostbusters themselves don't really have individual character arcs, at least not as they'd be recognized in screenwriting 101 today. Egon is exactly the same guy at the end of Ghostbusters as he is at the beginning of Ghostbusters. His personality doesn't change, he was never wrong about anything, and even the implication that he and Janine are eventually gonna hook up and make adorable nerd babies doesn't seem to really faze him. There's a sense that his Hail Mary saving throw at the end about crossing the streams is a way out of character move for him, but he comes out of things roughly the same guy.
I collect spores, molds, and fungus. We'd like to get a sample of your brain tissue.
Okay.
Ray undergoes even less of a shift. Befitting Dan Aykroyd's role in the crafting of the story and the world, he's the childlike mascot of the team, and the closest thing he has to an arc is right at the end when his attempt to thwart Gozer's scheme to draw the Destructor from the Ghostbusters' own imaginations by regressing into innocent memories of his youth, a coping tactic one can easily imagine Ray employs a lot in his life as it is, fails and instead conjures the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man. But while this mistake is noted, that both Ray and his colleagues mainly just shrug it off as, well, of course that's something Ray would do, befits his non-development. And yet, even devoid of anything resembling growth, Ray remains fully the heart and soul of the film, as he should.
I tried to think of the most harmless thing. Something I loved from my childhood. Something that could never, ever possibly destroy us. Mr. Stay Puft.
Nice thinking, Ray.
Even Peter, who feels the most like he should have an arc given that his would-be romance with Dana Barrett makes him the buster with the meatiest B-story, really doesn't. And if he does, it's over by Act 2 when we see his first honest reaction in being attacked by Slimer. Otherwise, Venkman's story is all about misdirection. We're told from the get-go, both by the film and the man himself, that Peter is the consummate con man and pickup artist, which is meant to be ironic since the Ghostbusters are performing for real a job, i.e. exorcism, usually undertaken by phonies, charlatans, and, well, con men.
What is that thing you're doing?
It's technical. It's one of our little toys.
I see. You know, you don't act like a scientist.
They're usually pretty stiff.
You're more like a game show host.
But for all the talk, we never really see Venkman prove that reputation all that well. Dana sees right through him, it's the basis of their relationship. And as such, what would be the payoff to his arc in a more conventional version of this narrative, i.e. the player gets played once Dana has been possessed by the seductress gatekeeper demon, is even more misdirection. As it turns out, ancient powers of manipulation are no match for 20th century sleeping pills. Keep that reference in your pocket, by the way, because we'll come back to that old versus new theme very shortly.
I just whacked her up with about 300 cc. Thorazine. She's gonna take a little nap now.
But, she says she's the gatekeeper. Does that make any sense to you?
On the other hand, Peter's lack of an authentic upfront hero's journey while still getting on balance more screen time than the other four Ghostbusters works largely because he's sharing his non-busting scenes with the great Sigourney Weaver, who, it's easy to forget, was still 2 years away from cementing her place as the first lady of American sci-fi blockbusters. For most of the film, Dana Barrett is a thankless role. She has to be the straight woman to literally every other character's comic shenanigans until Act 3, wherein she gets subsumed by the more broad characterization of the body-possessing Zool. And while she's not precisely the audience point of view character, she is the film's anchor. Gozer, Zool, and 55 Central Park West are scary because she's scared by them. We can accept that Venkman is actually a mostly decent guy because she seems to think so, and what non-comedic stakes the narrative has are indeed her stakes. In other words, she's sort of a plot device, and yet Weaver is so vibrant, real, and engaging in the part that Dana also works as a full-fledged character, and it never feels like the movie is just cutting back to her story because it has to. That's not easy to pull off. And while we're at it, special attention must be paid to how brilliantly Annie Potts inhabits a hard-to-pin-down yet instantly memorable character like Janine Melnitz, or how completely Rick Moranis commits to the outrageous caricature that is Louis Tully and the somehow even more bizarre Vince Clortho, the Keymaster. And of course, has anyone ever been better at playing a complete dick than William Atherton?
They caused an explosion. Is this true?
Yes, it's true. This man has no dick.
And then there's Winston Zeddemore. Let's talk about Winston Zeddemore.
I have seen shit that'll turn you white.
Everyone knows by now that Winston's role was originally written for Eddie Murphy, and you can see where that makes sense in terms of the meta-symbolism of the older guard SNL SCTV comics enlisting the face of the new generation. But surely the luck of not being able to get Eddie Murphy can't be overstated, and not just because of the hindsight factor where Eddie's eventual superstar status would have almost certainly turned Ghostbusters retroactively into an Eddie Murphy footnote where the biggest star is stuck in supporting duty. Yes, Ernie Hudson doesn't get an especially great amount of screen time as Winston, largely because he wasn't isn't as big a star as Murphy would have been even then, but he does end up providing a vital component without which the film wouldn't feel quite as unique as it does. Of the four Ghostbusters, Hudson is the lone non-comedian among sketch comedy veterans, and by choice or happenstance, that adds a welcome layer of metatext to Winston, since he's the odd man out in the story, too.
Do you believe in UFOs, astral projections, mental telepathy, ESP, clairvoyance, spirit photography, telekinetic movement, full transmediums, the Loch Ness Monster, and the theory of Atlantis?
If there's a steady paycheck in it, I'll believe anything you say.
Whereas Peter, Ray, and Egon are all scientists, either well-heeled or at least academically ensconced in their backgrounds, Winston is a regular guy, or at least he seems to be. In the original screenplay, he was meant to have been a former Marine and a multidisciplined PhD scientist who was almost cartoonishly more qualified than the three founders, but basically none of that ended up on screen. As a result, Winston is presented to us as an everyman, the audience POV character. In that respect, Hudson's energetic but grounded characterization humanizes and solidifies the proceedings in ways that, sorry, Eddie Murphy simply wouldn't have. Finally, Winston being, or at least seeming to be, a regular person who can learn to master the Ghostbusters technology feels very much a part of what might be the film's most unfairly overlooked element of quiet yet revolutionary subversion. Remember what I said about old versus new? Well,
Ray, when someone asks you if you're a god, you say yes!
One thing that sets the heroes of Ghostbusters apart from most of their contemporaries and nearly all 21st century blockbuster leads is that there isn't a chosen one or destined hero among them. Venkman, Stans, and Spengler are Ghostbusters because they discovered a way they could use their knowledge and skills to earn a living and to benefit the world. Zedmore is a Ghostbuster because he answered a help wanted ad. The qualifications for the role are wholly technical and real-world skills-based. These aren't knights or samurai or wizards or high priests, they're basically just supernatural pest control, and that's where the real genius of this whole enterprise resides. Now, to talk about this most important aspect, we need to digress a bit and recognize the ways in which Ghostbusters is somewhat a victim of its own success. While rightly seen today as an exemplar of the wild creativity associated with high-concept blockbusters in the 80s, it's easy to forget that this movie did not conjure its central plot element of ancient occult evil breaking out in modern Metropolis out of whole cloth. That particular aspect exists largely as a reaction to other films and aspects of the pop culture zeitgeist of its moment. A particular fascination with the supernatural, occultism, and even Satanism had gripped American popular culture from the mid-1970s well into the 80s, largely seen as part of a broader traditionalist reaction against the rising trend toward secularism in the late 1960s that saw, among other events, the mainstreaming of televangelism, moral panic about hidden messages in rock music, and culminating in the wholesale assimilation of the American right wing by the so-called religious right that helped push Ronald Reagan into political prominence at the beginning of the decade. While most visibly transformative in political and social realms, this shift also had a profound impact on genre fiction, particularly in film, where features like The Exorcist, The Omen, Rosemary's Baby, The Amityville Horror, and countless others literalized the demons among us rhetoric of the new revivalism with stories about demonic occult forces lingering in the shadows, repurposing imagery and rhetoric from medieval blood libel propaganda to more modern paranoia about Freemasonry or global government into tales of demons, devils, and even Lucifer himself rising in the conspiratorial backgrounds of the world's elite spaces, the inevitable result of a modern world turned from the one true God.
God is dead!
Hail Satan!
Satan lives! The year is won!
Ultimately and tragically giving rise to real-life satanic panic hysteria via books like Michelle Remembers and tabloid journalists sensationalizing tragic events like the McMartin preschool trial. But that serious stuff is another show. We're here to talk about movies.
What do you think I should do?
Lenny, officially, the church will not take any position on the religious implications of these phenomena. Personally, Lenny, I think it's a sign from God.
Now, since Ghostbusters is a comedy but not a parody, it doesn't really make explicit reference to any of that. But make no mistake, from the secret pagan altar covertly concealed within a strange but otherwise anonymous old building, Zool's netherworld hangout glimpsed in Dana Barrett's refrigerator, the unsettling subsequent tableaus of Dana being engulfed by demonic hands, gatekeeper Dana vamping on the altar in the red dress, the city skyline overrun with streaks of ghostly energy, the banal domesticity of the haunting sequences in the kitchen and Lewis Tully's house party, and Gozer itself standing triumphant with the terror dogs, Ghostbusters is marinated in visual iconography, signifying a connection to the popular culture's familiarity with then-recent possession haunting imagery, and also to more genre-savvy fans' shared reference points for D&D-style quasi-occult symbology and the 70s and 80s resurgent popularity of early 20th century pulp fantasists like H.P. Lovecraft, that one especially being an unspoken text influence that was later made explicit by an appearance by none other than Cthulhu himself in the spin-off animated series.
Thank you.
We're in serious trouble.
Of course, using immediately familiar aesthetic shorthand isn't in itself revolutionary. What's key is that Ghostbusters didn't merely stop at borrowing post-Exorcist horror scenario of a satanically infected New York for effect. It twisted the idea back around against itself to build up its own mythology and firmly establish its heroes as specifically subversive counterculture iconoclasts, ones whose subversion was so successful that it ultimately supplanted the icons they both swiped from and swatted at in the public imagination, to the extent that the sheer grandeur of their victory is all but lost to popular memory. To understand the why and how of that, you first need to ask yourself a simple question. What is Gozer?
Gozer was very big in Sumerian.
Well, what's he doing in my icebox?
Now, we're actually going to go before a federal judge and say that some moldy Babylonian god is going to drop in on Central Park West and start tearing up the city?
Sumerian, not Babylonian.
Yeah, big difference.
Gozer is a god, an ancient, prehistoric, and outside the context of the story, fictional god, yes, but a god all the same. In fact, despite all of the overly convoluted Lovecraftian backstory involving Zool, Vince Clortho, Keymaster, Gatekeeper, and so forth being needlessly overcomplicated for humorous effect by intent, the initial incarnation of Gozer is actually pretty well researched as these things go. There's a lot of subtle Freemason-esque detailing to the altar set, the terror dogs are an interesting mix of pagan and or occult animal iconography like goats, bulls, and hounds, along with medieval and gothic Christian gargoyles, and of course Gozer itself appearing in the form of a vaguely androgynous but subtly female-favoring form that fits comfortably into the framework of various prehistoric matriarchal goddess figures like those associated with pre-Olympian gods in pre-Hellenistic ancient Greece. Notably, while somewhat out of style today, the idea of a matriarchal nature cult being especially widespread among prehistoric humans was enjoying popular favor as a branch of hypothetical occult scholarship at the time this was written. But Gozer also incorporates elements closer to more familiar masculine-identified gods, specifically the god of Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. What's the humanoid Gozer's main special attack? Lightning bolts. And then there's the enemy's final form.
Choose the form of the destructor.
A giant booming voice in the clouds shouting down at humanity. It's easy to miss the daring significance of this visual given that it precedes the more iconic and Ghostbusters-specific introduction to Mr. Stay Puft, but think about it for a minute. In this moment, Gozer is largely indistinguishable from a decidedly Old Testament vision of not simply a god, but the god. And that's pretty damn interesting when you remember that the Ghostbusters aren't standing before Gozer as worshippers, sacrifices, or even rival religionists trying to work out a proper prayer or incantation to banish it.
We've been going about this all wrong. This Mr. Stay Puft is okay. He's a sailor. He's in New York. We get this guy laid, we won't have any trouble.
Yeah, you ever think about that? In most movies involving all-powerful deities or demigods, the finishing move tends to be finding a talisman or long-forgotten trick in the canon of the otherworldly fiend itself, with the explicit or implicit moral to the story almost always being that a familiarity with and respect for the old traditions is necessary to remain safe even in modernity. Remember, that's the underlying message of The Exorcist. If only Reagan's all-too-modern mom, a single mother acting in movies about leftist political activism, lest you forget, hadn't gone and raised her as a godless secular heathen, maybe she might not have needed an old priest-young priest tag team to keep Satan by way of Pazuzu from taking hold of her.
You killed your mother!
I'm just your servant!
You left her alone!
Reagan,
to die! Shut up! I'll never give you a
There is no day now, only soon.
What a lovely singing voice you must have.
Bring in the dead to depart from the servant of God. It's the power.
But that's not Ghostbusters. When Peter Venkman, Ray Stans, Egon Spengler, and Winston Zeddemore stand before Gozer the Gozerian, they are scientists of no discernibly notable religious disposition, except for Winston, sort of.
I love Jesus' style, you know.
Standing against a god, and they've come to defeat that god with science. Ghostbusters, fundamentally stripped to its core, is a movie about science versus superstition, the ascendant technological ingenuity of man, and as mentioned, not even special ingenuity that only certain benighted scientists can use. The Ghostbusters already refined their tech into a democratized, user-friendly form that even a newbie like Winston can evidently learn to wield in the course of a day or two, versus, literally, the ancient powers of the gods. And since nearly all modern stories about humanity's relation to ancient or fictional gods are subtextually about the relation of said story's society of origin to its own currently dominant spiritual belief systems, yeah, you see where this is going. Ghostbusters is a science versus religion story where religion gets its ass ass-handed to it.
We came, we saw, we kicked its ass!
Four men of science, representatives previously of a secular academia that institutionalizes the forward thrust of knowledge against belief and the Western city that most iconically symbolizes the upward ascendance of human progress, stand before an ancient, all-powerful, lightning-throwing voice from the clouds and declare in no uncertain terms, no, you don't get to win anymore. You don't get to be in charge anymore. Knowledge is power. We've got it. We know how to use it. Everything from the management of spirits to the date the world ends isn't under your control anymore. It's under ours. Or as Peter puts it,
let's show this prehistoric bitch how we do things downtown.
Now, once again, I am talking strictly subtext and metatext here, and not necessarily even intentional metatext at that. I'm certainly not looking to suggest some kind of goofy fan theory that, say, the prehistoric god Gozer and the modern understanding of the Judeo-Christian god are somehow one and the same.
The city is headed for a disaster of biblical proportion.
What do you mean, biblical?
What he means is Old Testament, Mr.
Yes.
Mayor. Real wrath of God type stuff.
Exactly. Dead rising from the grave.
Human sacrifice, dogs and cats living together.
Even though it fits in with a tradition of mythic appropriation and widely recognized historical record of monotheism assimilating polytheistic traditions. Or an even goofier fan theory that maybe the Ghostbusters aren't simply cancering out Gozer's world-ending shenanigans, but in fact thwarting God himself's plan for the actual biblically prescribed apocalypse from the Book of Revelation. Nope. Not at all. Firstly, because goofy fan theories are not what really that good is all about. And secondly, because I don't need to suggest that, the movie does it for me.
Judgment Day.
Judgment Day.
Every ancient religion has its own myth about the end of the world.
Myth? Ray, has it ever occurred to you that maybe the reason we've been so busy lately is because the dead have been rising from the grave?
Huh, yeah, Ray and Winston both seem a little bit more thoughtful about exactly who or what it is they're about to go to war with in that scene, huh? But again, I don't know or care if we were meant to take the Ghostbusters as atheist superheroes or something. I'm interested in subtext and symbology within the words and the moving pictures, and once you recognize the technology conquers superstition theme at the core of Ghostbusters, that symbology is everywhere. What's often seen as the very beginning of science, re-man taking control of powerful natural forces rather than seeing them as things to be feared and worshipped? The discovery of fire. What real-world heroic vocation are the Ghostbusters most explicitly associated with? Firemen.
Wow! This place is great! When can we move in? You gotta try this pole!
What's the role of a god in most spiritual systems? Creating and managing the universe. What's the universe made of? Atoms. What's the source of the Ghostbusters' spirit-wrangling and eventually god-killing powers?
Why worry? Each of us is wearing an unlicensed nuclear accelerator on his back.
They harness the energy from splitting those very atoms. Dana and Louis Tully are freed from their enslavement to Gozer by the literal smashing of decayed, powerless stone idols. Stone idols not unlike the one that looms large and imposing in the first shot of the film. Hell, if you really want to stretch things, both ectoplasm and the viscous remains of Stay Puft could easily be taken as flood, baptism, and rebirth imagery. Okay, or maybe not. I'm not here to claim that I'm the first person to point out that Ghostbusters is subtextually a science versus religion movie. And besides, while subtext and symbolism are interesting, they only mean so much without examining what their presence accomplishes in terms of how the work in question impacts its audience. And while I'd happily argue that the mere presence of these themes makes Ghostbusters a smarter, richer, more intellectually layered film than it's commonly understood to be, perhaps even by some of its biggest fans, that doesn't automatically explain why this isn't simply a good movie and a smart movie, but a great and beloved movie. But you know what might? I know it's been a few minutes and we've covered a lot of ground, but remember how I mentioned that it's an interesting screenwriting gamble for the heroes of Ghostbusters not to have conventional individual character arcs? Part of what's interesting is that you can see how easily a less inventive, more cookie-cutter screenplay would try to impose one. Just make one or two of the heroes outwardly and openly resistant to the idea that spirituality had any place in fighting ghosts, only to have their technology come up short against Gozer and said resistant heroes have to open their minds and get some magic talisman or spellbook or whatever for the real key to thwarting Armageddon, thus learning a lesson about considering other viewpoints and blah blah blah. You get the idea. Oh, hey, people writing the scripts for the new Ghostbusters movies? Yeah, that thing I just described? Don't do that. That would be stupid.
I think that would be extraordinarily dangerous.
In any case, the original Ghostbusters doesn't do that. And while in subtext that means it's a rare science versus God movie that comes down enthusiastically on the scientist side, and that's all well and good, in the actual text of the film, it means it's a movie about how all you need to rid the world of evil and darkness is the tools and the talent.
We have the tools, we have the talent!
Now that might be a foregone conclusion, or commonly shared fantasy of a just world order to you and me, but there are people for whom it's not. They're called children. Something else I mentioned back at the start was that one reason Ghostbusters is sometimes suspected to be overrated is that a lot of people who love it came to love it as children, and thus could be expected to be nostalgia blind to any hypothetical flaws it might have. When Ghostbusters hit in 1984, it had been 7 years since the advent of Star Wars, but a lot of Hollywood was still slowly absorbing the idea that children and teenagers had supplanted college age and adult moviegoers as the prime audience for blockbusters and the sci-fi fantasy genre in particular, and Ghostbusters is very much akin to Back to the Future, RoboCop, Terminator, Aliens, and Police Academy, and other films made for a decidedly adult audience that wound up being adopted with unexpected zeal by kids.
This university will no longer continue any funding of any kind for your group's activities.
But the kids love us.
Make no mistake, Ghostbusters is a movie made overwhelmingly for an adult audience. Sure, there are things in it that a younger crowd is inevitably going to zero in on, like monsters and lasers and... well, that's actually it, monsters and lasers, but they aren't even close to having majority screen time. Most of the movie is about grown-ups and grown-up stuff. Starting a business, money problems, flirting at work, dating, sex, ghost sex, legal trouble, red tape, and there's actually not a great deal of physical comedy either, with most of the humor being verbal digs, one-liners, and wordplay. Even the pop culture references are decidedly baby boomer-centric.
Very cute. Whatever we think of, if we think of J. Edgar Hoover, J. Edgar Hoover will appear and destroy us, okay? So empty your head!
So what was so appealing about it to children? Was it just the monsters and lasers? Remember, the home video era hadn't fully dawned yet, so the kids who were enraptured by Ghostbusters in 1984 largely became so watching it in theaters. Were the relatively brief on-screen appearances of Slimer and Mr. Stay Puft really so compelling that a generation of Gen X kids were willing to sit fidgety and bored through story points about the New York dating scene and haggling with regulators at work just to get to them? Well, it wouldn't be the first time that the world went nuts over a movie for only one or two scenes, but I don't think so. I think Ghostbusters spoke to kids, to everybody, but especially to a generation and now generations of youngsters, in a way that nobody could have predicted. The world of Ghostbusters is a world where big cosmic horrors are omnipresent but always just out of sight, where that creeping feeling of dread in an otherwise familiar house, or that something off about the banal sameness of a hotel hallway at night, or the unsettling staleness of an old library are evidence of lurking malevolent horrors, where that rustling in the bushes at night really is something evil out to get you, and that creepy stranger is more than just creepy, where something really is going bump in the night, hiding under the bed, lurking in the shadows, and yes, where there is a monster in the closet.
Okay, who brought the dog?
But if they scare you, you're likely to be told it's all in your head, or not really all that scary, or that you should get over it, which in turn is going to make you feel not only frightened, but alone. To children, that world is also known as the real world, day to day. Kids don't need to make much of a logical leap to understand a movie where people live at the mercy of seemingly malevolent forces beyond their understanding or control. Most of them feel like they're already living like that, day in and day out. But in the Ghostbusters world, there's something that can checkmate all that scary stuff. You.
According to these new readings, I think we have an excellent chance of actually catching a ghost and holding it indefinitely.
Well, this is great!
The subtext that underlines and empowers the narrative of Ghostbusters is science and technology overcoming superstition and the supernatural, but the practical surface text is monsters and ghosts being overcome by cool gadgets. And not cool gadgets powered by the same indeterminate scary stuff that the bad guys are made of, or cool gadgets that are rare and hard to find, or cool gadgets that only certain special people can use. It's made unmistakably clear that the Ghostbusters thought up, made, and maintained the proton packs, traps, PKE meters, and containment unit themselves, and that is all important for understanding the power of this particular power fantasy.
Turn your screens off as soon as I close the trap. Get ready. I'm closing it. Now!
The unique powerful fantasy idea at the heart of Ghostbusters isn't simply that ghosts and demons and things that go bump in the night are real, and it also isn't simply that they can be busted. It's that with the right equipment and a little bit of know-how, you can bust them. And while there is a grown-up appeal to that idea, particularly in the aforementioned subtextual man's conquest over God sense, the appeal of that to the mindset of kids is far more potent, more obvious, and more powerful. With cleverness and determination, you can take control of what scares you, assert your power over what lurks in the dark, and beat back the things that frighten you. And that core idea makes Spengler, Stans, Venkman, and Zedmore more than just movie heroes. It makes them the spirit animals of every kid who ever set a trap for the monster under their bed, or even stayed awake trying to catch a glimpse of the Tooth Fairy.
We're ready to believe you!
Incidentally, this was another idea later realized in more explicit terms by the more deliberately kid-focused animated series, wherein the Ghostbusters fought the literal boogeyman, revealing that this specter in particular played an all-important role in inspiring Egon's commitment to mastering the how and why of blasting away the supernatural.
I remember you.
Egon, move!
No. Not again.
Which, of course, makes perfect sense. Just like the fantasy of being a Ghostbuster appealing so strongly to audiences of young kids makes perfect sense, even though the filmmakers had never planned it that way.
When I was a child, the boogeyman would come out of my closet. He's the reason I started investigating the supernatural. I wanted to find a way to stop him.
Really That Good is a show about positivity, but accentuating the positive of good movies doesn't mean ignoring flaws, denying issues, or glossing over the problematic. Ghostbusters is a truly great film. If you're not convinced of that by now, why are you even still watching this? But it's not a perfect film, and imperfections deserve notice amid the praise. The storytelling in Act 2 leans a little bit heavy on montage. Louis Tully is kind of a thin character relative to how much screen time and story investment he gets, while by contrast, Janine and Winston both feel like they could have used a bit more. The ghost blowjob is a funny gag, but it feels out of touch with the rest of the film, and the importance of crossing, or rather not crossing, the proton streams could have stood at least one more hat tip between the hotel sequence and the finale if we're talking structural business.
We'll cross the streams.
Excuse me, Egon. You said crossing the streams was bad.
Cross the streams.
More substantively, while it holds up better than just about any other 80s movie featuring a supposed ladies' man hero does in this regard, yeah, Venkman's pickup artist routine does feel more and more a little skeevy as time goes on. Granted, the film does a good job at subverting this and the story proper, with his introductory scene falsifying the psychic test, making it pretty clear that we're to recognize this behavior marking Peter as kind of a dick, and Dana, an independent-minded, successful grown woman, not buying his shtick for a minute and seeing right through to the presumably redeemable Ghostbuster within right away. That's fine, sure, but then you remember that nobody has that many go-to lines, to say nothing of self-confidence, without putting in a lot of practice at it, and you recall that Peter held a position of some power at a co-ed university for years, and yeah, the unquestioned presence of this kind of character as just a playfully rakish scoundrel is the sort of thing that can't help but date the film, and not in a good way.
Tell you what, I'll take Miss Barrett back to her apartment and check her out. I'll go check out Miss Barrett's apartment.
And then there's the Walter Peck subplot. Yeah, that thing. Peter Venkman getting even less pushback for his creeper tendencies than, say, Glenn Quagmire is some bad old days cold water to the face of Ghostbusters' otherwise warm and fuzzy 80s nostalgia factor, but the red herring villain being an environmental regulator with actually pretty reasonable concerns about nuclear tech in the middle of a city is a genuine eye-roller, an unfortunate relic of the Reagan-era backlash culture cynically reframing the disastrous corporate-filleting rollback of federal health, safety, and general welfare regulations in terms of idealized small business Davids beset by bureaucratic Goliaths.
We want to assess any possible environmental impact from your operation. For instance, the presence of noxious, possibly hazardous waste chemicals in your basement.
Rendered even more unfortunate by how at odds it is with the film's otherwise smart and decidedly forward-looking themes of scientific progress, entrepreneurship for the common good, class consciousness, and even a reassertion of the melting pot metropolis that is New York City as a societal pinnacle worth defending. On the other hand, I'm inclined to at least give the film credit for casting Peck strictly in terms of a petty tyrant, not necessarily representative of his vocation.
Get him out of here.
Bye.
I'll fix you, Venkman. I'm gonna fix you.
I'm gonna get you a nice fruit basket.
Hell, there's not even any trite, overly tidy reveal that he's somehow working for or influenced by Gozer. And you'd better believe that if they wrote this today, that's exactly what would end up happening. Studio notes would demand it. Also, yeah, well-intentioned red tape making a creative pain in the ass for startup businesses is a thing that happens. Sorry, it is.
I've never seen anything like this before. I don't
know. I'm not interested in your opinion. Just shut it off.
We'll be right back. Even while acknowledging the film's imperfections, the relative triviality of their presence mainly serves to highlight just how startlingly close to perfection the total package actually gets. Upon full inspection, its component parts broken down, analyzed from all possible angles, studied bit by bit under the metaphorical microscope, and reassembled for posterity and a more complete reappreciation, Ghostbusters isn't just a good movie or a great film, its existence is something close to a miracle.
This is it! This is the sign!
The ingenious premise of exorcists as high-tech exterminators is inventive enough that you'd almost have to try to make a boring movie out of it, granted. And 1984 was indeed the ideal moment in both the development of modern special effects blockbuster and the overall pop culture zeitgeist for such ideas to first be explored in. Sure, and both the grown-up skewing subtext of scientific conquest over mystic superstition and kid-empowering surface text of your worst fears being no match for creative know-how are pretty much always going to work in terms of audience engagement, acknowledged.
I love this plan! I'm excited to be a part of it.
But that it also maintains such an easygoing, deceptively laid-back, jovial comic tone, that it feels so loose, unkempt, and anarchic even as it fires the imagination of the young and prods the humor center of the older, that it comes across so effortless and idiosyncratic even as it builds a complete lived-in world, develops iconic three-dimensional characters, lays out a functional, comprehensive mythology while also making fun of mythology and deftly satirizing a genre and the culture swirling around it, and covertly challenging the beliefs and worldview of a huge chunk of its prospective audience so subtly many of them doubtlessly didn't pick it up, that's not supposed to be possible. That's not supposed to happen. And that's definitely not supposed to work. Not while also being so funny, so exciting, so imagination expanding, this subversive, this meaningful, this compulsively watchable, and absolutely not with this once-in-a-lifetime confluence of such specific talents behind and in front of the camera.
Many shrubs and zools knew what it was to be roasted in the depths of the slore that day, I can tell you.
But it did happen. And while it might be talked to death by some fans, championed for exactly the wrong reasons by others, and indeed overpraised in the grand scheme of things, it holds up. The damn silly thing holds up. Ghostbusters holds up. Ghostbusters is as good as you remember. Ghostbusters is smarter than you might have given it credit for. Ghostbusters is deeper than you may have considered. Ghostbusters matters. Ghostbusters counts. And that's why Ghostbusters is really that good.